Gordon Wood is a name that I'm sure is familiar to all of you. He is an eminent Revolutionary War scholar. His most recent book is The Idea of America. Steven Pincus is a very promising expert on British imperial experience. His tome is called 1688, which discusses many different interesting aspects of what the English call the Glorious Revolution, which ended the Stuart monarchy and replaced it with the Georgians. Gentlemen, I'll leave it to you to introduce your topic.
Well, thank you very much, John. It's a pleasure to be here talking to people who know a lot about the American Revolution. We don't have any prepared texts. This is going to be a conversation between Steve and me about the coming of the revolution. We thought we would start our conversation, go until it maybe gets tired, and then open it up to you for questions. We are not going to take the position of defending each of our respective arenas. For example, I'm not going to be trying to just defend the colonists against a tyrannical British, and Steve is certainly not going to dismiss the Americans as a bunch of crazy rebels. So we're trying to explain rather than defend. I thought we would start, I would start by asking Steve, why did the British, in the middle of the 18th century, begin to tighten up its empire? After all, for the first half of the century, they had more or less let the colonies alone, and all of a sudden, they begin to tighten up.
Well, first of all, let me also say what a pleasure it is to be here. As a British historian, I feel awed by the learning about the American Revolution in the room. So I'll try not overwhelmingly to defend tyranny as a good thing. although maybe there will be a tendency that way. So the question that Gordon asks is a really good one. Why did British policy in the middle of the 18th century? Okay, great. Why did British policy in the middle of the 18th century seem to change towards the American colonies? And there's three levels that I want to sort of think about the answer to that. Now, the overarching context is a context which should be familiar to all of us, that is fiscal crisis. But I think one needs to sort of parse that, and there are three things that I want to focus on. The first is the national debt had been a problem for Britain and its empire, not just beginning with the Seven Years' War, but since the War of the Spanish Succession. Because of that, there were various moments throughout the 18th century in which the British Empire toyed with tightening up control over its various colonies and dependent kingdoms. And the result of various measures for this, now most of them went away, but the result of various of these measures led to earlier revolts against taxation without representation. When I say that, I'm referring to the so-called Jacobite rebellions of 1715 and 1745, in which the Scots were furious after the Anglo-Scottish Union of 1707 that they, in fact, were being taxed extremely heavily. They were being taxed at English levels with very little representation. In fact, the Scots, while being given representation in Parliament in Westminster, their representation was less than that of the single English county of Cornwall. And another moment of crisis of taxation without representation, which happened in the earlier part of the 18th century, was in the 1720s, when the Irish became absolutely furious with the imposition of Wood's halfpence, not Gordon Wood's halfpence, William Wood's halfpence, which infuriated the Irish and led to the great novelist Jonathan Swift to write Gulliver's Travels. But before that, he wrote the Drapier's Letters, which complained that the Irish were being heavily taxed by an English government, he said, without representation. And a similar story could be told about Jamaica, but I won't. So that's the first context. It's a long crisis, about the national debt. And one needs to understand that before 1688, English governments had virtually no debt, zero debt. And by the 1750s, the British, the state of the national debt was about 1.5 times the gross domestic product. That's a big debt. Second point is that it needs to be understood in terms of party politics. That is to say, when we think about the 1750s and 1760s. And there were three basic positions that were taken within Britain with respect to the fiscal crisis. And they were associated with increasingly congealing political parties. So how do you deal with a fiscal crisis? How do you deal with a huge debt? Position one is austerity, right? You try to pay down the debt, and you try to raise taxes to do that. And that was the position associated with a group that a bunch of younger scholars have called authoritarian Whigs. These are the people that we all hear about: George Grenville, the Earl of Bute, Lord North, Charles Townshend, etc. So you pay down the debt by taxing the colonies very, very heavily. Second group is you try to get rid of the debt by fostering growth, by fostering massive economic growth as quickly as possible. And that was a position associated with people like William Pitt, the Elder, Joseph Massey, Henry Seymour Conway, and William Beckford, and the Earl of Shelburne. This is that group of people. Then there's the third group. I mean, what do you do? There's, you know, two possibilities. You either grow your way out of debt and austerity. The third possibility is you pretend the debt isn't there or isn't a problem. And that's the position that's most closely associated with the Rockingham Whigs and Edmund Burke. So there are different ways of approaching the problem, and one has to think about that. And there seems to be a certain amount of contemporary resonance to that. The third, well, I don't know. The third sort of element is that I think one needs to understand what happened to the North American colonies in a broader imperial setting. It's important to understand that at the same time, the same year, that the Imperial Parliament in Westminster passed the Stamp Act, they also received the Diwani for Bengal. And why is that important? Well, the Diwani for Bengal is a very, very heavy tax on manufacturers in Bengal. And just to give you a sense, so the average revenue that Britain was gaining from the North American colonies in the 1760s was somewhere between 38 and 45,000 pounds a year. I mean, there's some dispute about that, and Gordon can tell me exactly what it is. The amount of money that the British government was getting from the Diwani after 1765 was 400,000 pounds a year. So it's a huge amount of money, and this has long-term consequences. The effect of these kinds of taxes actually destroyed the manufacturing sector in Bengal. Bengal produced calicos that were being imported into Europe at very high levels and other forms of textiles, and this sort of taxation destroyed that. At the same time, Britain lowered the land tax in England. So there was part of a coherent tax policy. And finally, and this is just a sort of the same people, Grenville, George Grenville, and his many brothers were instrumental in completely radicalizing or transforming the political economy of Ireland. So up until Grenville's administration, Ireland, which had its own separate treasury, was spending a huge amount of money on public works projects. Building roads, building harbors, using the revenue from Ireland to develop Ireland. The same policies which led to the Stamp Act completely eliminated these public works projects in Ireland. Any of you driven on Irish roads recently will sort of understand the effects of that. And instead took the money that was being used to use public works in Ireland to try to pay down the British debt, which led to outrage in Ireland.
Well, that's a long-winded answer to a... to a question, I would actually add important facts that the colonies were becoming far more important to the English, first of all, in population. The colonists were growing faster than any people in the Western world, doubling about every 20 to 25 years. And no other state in Europe was multiplying that fast. So that in 1700, there was one colonist, and I'm talking about the North American colonists, one colonist for every 20 Englishmen. By 1770, there was one colonist for every 5 Englishmen. So you have that enormous growth of population. In addition, the trade has become far more important. In fact, I don't have the figures right on the top of my head, but something like 20% of English trade by 1770 is with the colonies, where it had been infinitesimal earlier in the century. So you have that growth of population to add to the concern. And in addition, of course, the biggest thing, and this is what we might just talk a little bit, but not lecture on. is the results of the war. Of 7 years' war, or what we Americans call the French and Indian War, that I think changed everything. Although I think Steve is quite right, the factors lying behind strengthening the empire go back to the early 1750s, and at least when you have efforts to strengthen the empire. But you might say something about what the War of the French and Indian War resulted. The peace. What were the consequences of that?
Well, the consequences from a British perspective. Let me sort of lay aside the imperial perspective. The consequences of the British perspective was an intensification of party politics. Why? Because the great hero from the British side of the war, the great ministerial hero, was William Pitt the Elder. After George III comes to power, he imposes his favorite, his close friend, his former tutor, the Earl of Bute, on Pitt.
But let me ask you a question about Pitt. Why does he, there's a choice to be made at the end of the war between the British taking Guadeloupe and Martinique, which are French sugar-producing colonies, or Canada. And Canada has, at this point, nothing but a few Frenchmen and this vast wilderness, and yet they choose. Why do you think that Pitt chose?
Well, this was. I mean, Pitt didn't choose. I mean, this is.
Well, the administration. He was influential.
Well, I mean, so there was a huge debate in Britain about whether or not to give back Guadeloupe and Martinique. And one has to realize, I mean, Guadeloupe and Martinique, we now think of as, you know, nice places to go on holiday. But in the 18th century, they were incredibly productive sugar islands, much more productive, much more efficiently productive in the production of sugar than the British islands of Jamaica or Barbados. So they were fantastically wealthy. The British had conquered them, taken them in the Great Year of Wonders of 1759. Why give them back? Well, there's two positions. The position that Bute and Grenville and others in the administration, like Viscount Barrington, had is if we don't give them back, the French will never agree to peace immediately, and we can't afford to continue fighting the war. And Canada, by contrast, that will consolidate our position in North America. They knew that the French were in negotiations to give Louisiana to the Spanish, so they felt that they would be safe in North America, and they wouldn't have to spend as much money defending the colonies. Pitt's position was, this is crazy. We're, in fact, giving the French the economic resources to rebuild, to refinance, and fight a new war. And this becomes the stuff of the most bitter partisan debate in Britain in 1762, 1763. The two most influential newspapers, but there were two others that were very influential, were The Briton, written by the novelist Tobias Smollett, which defended the policy, and The North Briton, written by John Wilkes, which was on the Pittite side.
So let me add what I think and embellish that. Of course, the end of the war, the French are eliminated from the North American continent. I mean, that's just a basic fact. They retain a couple of islands off of Newfoundland, but essentially the whole of North America up to the Mississippi is now British. So that French presence that, so to speak, the colonists were always aware of, and of course had been they had been engaged in the French and Indian War, are gone. And so that gives them a certain. But in addition to that, now you're going there are have to be forts, because there's still a French presence in Canada. There has to be forts maintained by the English in the West, in Detroit or Niagara and so on, to protect, presumably protect the colonists or the British territorial hold on this Western land. And that's expensive. To maintain a fort like that is expensive. And in fact, Amherst, who is the commander-in-chief, says it's going to cost us, we're going to need 10,000 troops, and the estimated cost was about £300,000 a year. Now, that's an enormous amount of money, and as Steve says, the debt, I think at this point, coming out of the war, was £137 million, which is, by today's standards, very small, but the interest on that debt was £5 million a year, and that was the normal peacetime budget for the for England was about £8 million a year. So £5 million just to pay the interest. We may eventually reach that point too if your interest rates start to go up. So suddenly you've got a situation where you have all of this land that's been acquired that has to be policed because you can't count on the local militia because there are no Englishmen out there. And you've got Indian presence that are threatening. In fact, the English took over, the British government took over superintending the Indians in the mid-1750s. Up to that time, they'd left it to each of the colonies, the provinces, to do that. So they're aware of the Indians, they're aware of the French presence. You need a military force. You've got tremendous debt. You've got soldiers coming back home saying, wow, those colonists living in the land of milk and honey, and it's probably true, although it's hard to estimate this, that the highest standard of living of for at least for whites in the Western world, and that probably means the world, were the American colonists. So you have these, I think, various things coming together that seem normal and certainly imperative that the British tax these people. So that led to, well, first you don't have a tax with the Navigation Act of 1764. It's a kind of tightening up of the of the navigation system, which had bred corruption because there had been a prohibition on the importation of French molasses into North America. The reason for that was the British West Indies, molasses being a byproduct of sugar production, and you can turn it into rum. And the British West Indian planters wanted a monopoly of that, and that's why the Molasses Act of 1733 was passed. No French molasses. The reason the French didn't care about molasses because they didn't want rum to be a rival to their own cognac and wine industry. So this is the way things worked. The molasses was coming in all the time in my own state or colony at that point of Rhode Island. Rum manufacturing was a major, major institution. So all of a sudden now, they put a duty on it of 6 pence a gallon, which were a prohibitory duty. It was not designed to raise revenue. Now they lower the duty to 3 pence, and then within a year or so down to 1 pence a gallon. Suddenly, they're gonna make money from it. And instead of trying to prohibit the importation of molasses, since they couldn't do that anyhow, there was corruption everywhere, and the molasses flowed into New England, they are now going to lower and raise money. But that was not objected to on constitutional grounds, because it was simply seen as another aspect of the navigation system, regulating the navigation system, the flow of trade. But the next act, the Stamp Act, was.
That's right. And I think what one needs to sort of understand is that George Grenville, who became Prime Minister after Bute's fall, had a very coherent political economic strategy. It was a coherent political economic strategy to, as Gordon says, to figure out a way to get the colonies to pay for these increasing costs. The problem from the perspective of Grenville's opponents, William Pitt being the leader, I mean, who's ironically his brother-in-law, William Pitt's position was, and the position of the so-called radical Whigs, was the problem with that is it's true that North American population is growing and that North Americans are extremely wealthy. But from their perspective, this is a good thing because they understand the economy of the empire in terms of different regions. And what they see as the potentially most productive part of the empire after the Seven Years' War is precisely North America. Why? Because the population is growing, and North Americans have these huge consumer demands. These consumer demands will, in turn, support the development of new manufacturers, new things in Britain. And so the idea from Pitt's point of view is it's a very bad idea to raise taxes on the colonists because it's going to take money out of their pockets, which they then won't spend on British manufacturers. So he and his supporters object to the Sugar Act of 1764. William Pitt, as a very young man, had objected to the Molasses Act of 1733. And when Pitt becomes prime minister, briefly for his last moments of great sanity, when he is prime minister, Pitt is gradually going insane and getting extremely ill as an old man. But he passes the Freeport Act in 1766, and the idea of the Freeport Act is exactly the opposite of what the Sugar Act was trying to do. What the Freeport Act was trying to do was to increase commerce with the French West Indies, but more importantly, to increase commerce with Spanish America. Why was this? There's this massive population in Spanish America, huge population, dwarfing the population even of North America, and the Spanish have been so focused for so long on extracting silver out of the mines in Mexico and Peru that they've destroyed domestic or indigenous manufacturing. So there's huge demand in Spanish America for manufactured goods, especially cloth and silverware. And so the idea of the Freeport Act was to funnel British manufacturers legally into Spanish America. So that was okay.
Well, the Stamp Act, as you perhaps know, really changed everything because it was the first time that the English had levied a direct tax on America, in this case, American paper products, mostly playing cards, newspapers, legal documents, and so on. And the outcry was instantaneous and everywhere. There's not a single stamp that was issued. Every stamp agent was mobbed and forced to resign under threat of his life. So from this moment on, there's a Congress, a Stamp Act Congress that meets in New York. Most of the colonies showed up, and they issued a series of declarations, one of which said, we are entitled to all the rights of Englishmen, and that's important to keep in mind. We don't want to lose some of the obvious things here in this conversation. Yeah. No. They appeal to the rights of Englishmen, among which is the right not to be taxed without consent of their representatives. And since by local circumstances we cannot be represented by the House of Commons, that representation must be in our provincial legislatures. From that position, they never deviated. But there was a problem for the colonists because they had agreed, and I think constitutionally they had agreed, that Parliament had a right to regulate the trade. They had agreed to the Navigation Acts of the 17th century. They had agreed essentially to they never really protested the Molasses Act in constitutional terms. They all agreed that Britain had a right to regulate their trade, but did not have a right to tax them. Now the problem emerges, and this is that they're trying to explain their experience. So they go through a series in this debate that opens up now in the mid-60s, one of the great debates in Western culture over the nature of representation and over the nature, ultimately, of sovereignty. Now the first thing was representation. the English respond, and you can elaborate on this, the English respond by saying, look, you are represented in the House of Commons. You're virtually represented. They actually use that term, which is now part of our cyberspace. You're virtually represented. He said, look, we have people in England that don't elect representatives. There's the burgeoning cities of Manchester and Leeds and Birmingham, which have 50,000 people in them, and they don't vote for anybody, member of parliament. There's Old Sarum, which has no subjects, just a lord appoints them. And the Dunwich, the town of Dunwich, had long slipped into the North Sea, but still sent two representatives to the House of Commons. Yeah. Now, from an American point of view, that was absurd. If you can understand, the American conception of representation was built, and they called it actual representation. Now, the British system, and I virtual representation is quite defensible, and maybe we can get into that, but the basic assumption is that that election is incidental to representation. Incidental, how the guy gets there doesn't matter. It's what he stands for, and it's the mutuality of interest between him and his and the constituency, the commons, if you will, that really matters. Now, for the Americans, election is the criterion of representation. If you can follow what I'm saying, if you don't elect, then you're not represented. If you can't vote, then you're not represented. Now, the English could not hold that system. Only one out of six adult males could vote. In America, it's a lot better. It's about two out of three adult white males could vote. And for Americans, the process of election became central. And their sense of representation, unlike the English, which had grown up over the centuries and all of the residential requirements had fallen away. And as you know, even today, a member of parliament does not have to be a resident in the constituency he or she represents. But in America, that became very crucial. And representation in America grew up gradually, and people could remember when a new town was created in Massachusetts, they get two people. Two men to send to the general court. When a new county is created in Virginia, and this was in human memory, two members were sent to the House of Burgesses. In England, the whole process is lost in the mists, essentially in the mists of time, and there's a justification that Burke sets forth in his Bristol speech for virtual representation. But I would actually give a new, which I haven't heard anyone make, if election is the criterion of representation, and the guy you voted for doesn't win, are you represented by his opponent? Think about it. Many of you would probably agree you're not. But the British would not have a problem with that, because the conception of representation does not depend on voting, on election. And so they could easily accommodate. The political problem or the philosophical problem is, are you represented by somebody that you didn't vote for? And I think that's a justification that I would give for virtual representation. But anyway, the debate was a momentous one and went on for a decade from 65 to the Declaration of Independence. Did you want to add to that, Steve?
I think what Gordon says is absolutely right. But one needs to understand that on the British side, I mean, we all know about the protests against the Stamp Act in North America. On the British side, there were massive protests against the Stamp Act as well. There were riots. I have a sort of map that shows you. I mean, there were actually 67 different localities that had some sort of in England itself, just England alone, that had protests of various forms against the Stamp Act. There was obviously wide circulation of pamphlets. There was criticism of the Stamp Act in newspapers as well. And ultimately, Grenville's government falls because of the Stamp Act. Now, the problem on the British side is that there were two different arguments against the Stamp Act that were incompatible on constitutional grounds. So the position of the Rockinghamite Whigs associated with Edmund Burke was precisely, as Gordon says, there's nothing wrong constitutionally, according to Burke and the Rockinghamites, with the Stamp Act. It was simply imprudent. It was bad economics. It hit the Americans in a way that was bad for Britain. It was going to hurt imports. It was going to hurt exports. Hurt the British economy, the imperial economy. That was the rocking him, I'd argument. There was another argument associated with William Pitt and his groups, and it was very heavily elaborated in a series of pamphlets that get circulated. And the key thinker along William Pitt, on William Pitt's side was a man by the name of Joseph Massey. Massey was a very learned, very sophisticated political economic thinker. In fact, he was deeply influential for the later thinking of Adam Smith. What Massey says is, Burke completely misunderstands the nature of representation. It's not about virtual representation. It's about the representation of economic interests. So in fact, we need to reform the entire body of representation in the imperial parliament. It's not okay that Manchester doesn't have representation. It's not okay that this booming manufacturing town doesn't have representation in parliament. It's not okay that Old Sarum, with its five voters, gets two MPs. That's wrong. It's also wrong that North America doesn't have any representation, Jamaica doesn't have any representation, and what we need to do is reform the Constitution in a radical way.
But Steve, doesn't that take place till 1830s, right?
It doesn't actually happen, but it is the position. It's important to understand why the opponents of Grenville can't agree. So there's a powerful opposition to Grenville, and Grenville's government falls, but there are two different arguments. One is that it was imprudent, and one is that it was fundamentally unconstitutional. And that's why there's a sort of incoherence on the British political side.
Well, and of course, accompanying these protests that the colonists did against the Stamp Act are non-importation agreements, which are the beginnings, in American history at least, of what we now come to call economic sanctions, if you think about it. There's a direct line from the non-importation agreements of the 1760s to the Jefferson's embargo of 1807, all the way to the economic sanctions which we are now imposing on Iran. So these economic sanctions did have an effect on British, although Steve's right, Grenville falls, and the Rockingham Whigs take over for a year, and they do one big thing. They do away with the Stamp Act, but they accompany that repeal, which is very difficult for the House of Commons to do, Parliament. We have to understand how important Parliament is in English consciousness. For them to take back what they've just done is very, very difficult. They call in Benjamin Franklin, to testify, and because he's the most famous American that they know of, and he advises them, you've got to get rid of this Stamp Act, even though he himself had not been all that upset by it. And so they repeal it, but they pass the Declaratory Act, which says we, the Parliament, I'll translate it into modern language, don't get any ideas by our repeal that we don't have the right to do it. We have the right to do anything, essentially. All aspects whatsoever are under Parliament's sovereignty. Well, that issue eventually emerges by the late there's an important pamphlet written by one of these sub-ministers, William Knox, where he lays it out in graphic terms. He says, if you accept Parliament's authority in one little aspect, you have to accept it in all aspects because of this doctrine of sovereignty, which William Blackstone made famous in his commentaries on the law. But if you deny, Knox says, if you deny Parliament's authority in one iota, then you have to deny it all. You're totally independent of Parliament. Well, the assumption being that if you give the colonists that kind of choice, well, of course, no right-thinking, liberal-thinking Englishman would ever want to be out from Parliament's authority because Parliament is the bulwark of their liberties. And that is something the colonists never quite appreciate. For Englishmen, and this goes back to what Steve knows best, which is the Glorious Revolution, that Parliament is the source and protector of English liberty, and no good Whig would ever doubt that. And the colonists aren't quite so sure about that. And when they're given that choice, and Thomas Hutchinson, following Knox, not because he read Knox, but because it's part of the climate, in January of 1773, he is the last civilian governor of the colony of Massachusetts. He goes before the general court and says the same thing Knox did. He says, you either accept Parliament's authority in all matters, or if you deny Parliament's authority in one measure, you're going to be totally independent. Well, Samuel Adams and John Adams give a response from the House of Representatives. If that's our choice, then we're totally independent of Parliament. Now keep that in mind, because in the next year, 1774, there are a series of pamphlets written by all of those that we consider the major founders and some secondary founders. John Adams, Alexander Hamilton, Franklin, James Wilson, Thomas Jefferson, all come to the conclusion that the colonies are not under Parliament's authority at all. They're tied solely to the king. Now this has been called by historians a Commonwealth theory of the empire, because it anticipates the Statute of Westminster of 1931, which is essentially how the British Commonwealth operates. As you know, the legislatures of Australia and Canada and New Zealand are all free of, they don't have to kowtow to Parliament, but they do have a common tie with the Queen, with the monarch. And that's what the colonists' position was, the position they had reached by 1774. I think not because they had anticipated this, they're forced into it intellectually by this formidable argument that there must be in every state one final supreme lawmaking authority. And that the British keep throwing that in their faces, and they finally say, they keep trying to divide it. Oh no, we'll agree to some authority of Parliament as in trade matters, but not in others. And the Brits keep coming back saying, no, you can't have it. It's not divisible. It has to be, sovereignty is indivisible. And they're stuck with that, and they're forced into this position of denying Parliament's authority entirely.
So, I mean, I think it's important. I mean, I completely agree with sort of Gordon's account. There are two things that I think from a British perspective that one needs to, or maybe three things that one needs to understand. The first is that the Declaratory Act is a sense of deja vu. When was the first Declaratory Act passed? 1720 was the first Declaratory Act, and that was with respect to Ireland.
Right.
And the thing that's really important about that is, what was the Irish response? Well, there were two separate Irish responses. One, associated with the Irish Tories, and Jonathan Swift, was, you completely misunderstand, the British Parliament has no authority in Ireland. Ireland is a separate kingdom. We are subject only to the king, not to Parliament. That's Swift's position. Second position is the Patriot position, associated with the Patriot Whigs in Ireland, and saying, no, you can't do this. You can't tax us without representation. The conclusion from the Declaratory Act is what needs to happen is Ireland needs to be directly represented in the Imperial Parliament. That's where the debate is, what ends up happening is Walpole, for various complicated reasons, cuts an economic deal and essentially buys off the Patriots in Ireland, and the Declaratory Act stands. But the important thing is that was very much alive in the memory of the North Americans, because you see in so many of these newspapers, like the Virginia Gazette, for example, over and over again, these references to, they're going to make us just like Ireland. The second point that I wanted to make is that it's important to realize that William Knox was an extremely important advisor to George Grenville. Grenville had a sort of triumvirate of important economic thinkers, Thomas Whately, William Knox, and Alexander Wedderburn. The important thing to know about Knox is he's a Georgian. He's from Georgia, made his wealth, he's originally from Ireland, but he makes his wealth in Georgia. And there's a sense in which Grenville is defending his positions, claiming that there's some sentiment in North America taking the same position, which is obviously what Hutchinson does as well. The third point is that there remains a radical critique within Britain of this position. So it's important to realize the Declaratory Act is an act enunciated by the Rockinghamite Whigs, a faction of the Whig Party, appealing to the Tory opponents, right? Because you're saying that we have the constitutional right to do this. We agree with the Tories that we have the constitutional right to do this. We disagree with the Tories that it's good economics. That's the position of the Rockinghamite Whigs. Whereas the radical Whigs insist, and they continue to insist, that no, if you have bad institutions, you have bad economics. So we can't allow this. And this whole argument about sovereignty makes absolutely no sense because there's different levels of sovereignties in different parts of the empire anyway. So they look to, they point to India, they point to Scotland, they point to Ireland, and they argue that what we need to do is we need to come up with a coherent imperial strategy, and the way to do this is to radically rethink representation. Now, by the 1770s, that position had been very, very powerful in the 1760s. It had been very powerful in the 1750s. By the 1770s, that's becoming a much weaker position. Why is that? Because of all of the unrest that Gordon's talking about in North America and all of the unrest in Britain, and a number of kind of moderates who were willing to go along with this radical position as long as William Pitt was leading armies to win all these wars, suddenly fear the social unrest, the social consequences of this, this sort of radically increasing the representation from the towns, which is and giving support to manufacturers, the people who were selling stuff to North America and their consumers, they feared this was going to lead to social unrest, and indeed it had led to social unrest. So what ends up happening in 1765, 1766, the Americans have a wide-ranging support among a sector of the British population. And that basically goes away, it doesn't completely go away. There's constantly friends of the Americans, but they're an increasingly smaller percentage of the British population. And I think the way to understand that is to understand the sort of social changes which are going on in Britain during this time and the way people are responding to the unrest.
No, I think that's very true. I think the English context helps shape English actions. I want to go back a little bit to the stages here. The English interview Franklin in 1766, and he throws out this notion of external, internal taxes. We object to internal taxes, but not external taxes. Well, Chancellor Townshend comes in with the Pitt ministry, and he says, well, that's what we'll give them, and he passes a whole series of taxes on certain goods, paint, and a number of goods, including tea. And this is to be the beginning of we're going to just tax externally to the goods that are shipped into the colonies are going to be taxed, if that's what the Americans want. Of course, the Americans, Franklin didn't really know much about internal American opinion. He's been away so long in London, and there was not much support for this distinction. Nonetheless, the ministry responds to it, but again, there's outcry. There's protests, non-importation agreements, and the British Parliament takes away all these taxes, except one. They leave one on tea, as North says, as a sign that we have the right to do it. Well, that sets up a situation for those radicals in Massachusetts, led by Samuel Adams, who probably had independence in mind from at least the late 60s. He has an opportunity now to create some trouble, and that is the famous Tea Party of December of 1773, where a bunch of Bostonians disguised as Mohawk Indians, led by Samuel Adams, throw 10,000 pounds of tea into Boston Harbor. Now, I mean pounds in value, which would be in millions, several million dollars today. So this is a destruction of property. Most Englishmen do not like their property destroyed, so there's an outcry everywhere. And Franklin is really embarrassed by this. He's willing to pay, he's a very wealthy man, out of his own pocket, the cost of the tea, because he's so embarrassed. The Virginians are absolutely appalled by the actions of these wild Presbyterians in Massachusetts. And I know there are a lot out here, Puritans, which is they assume Presbyterians, congregational, are all this Puritans up in New England, and they're the ones who've caused all this trouble. So it's a really hairy, scary moment, I think, in 1773, in the aftermath of this Tea Party. And you have to understand that the Virginians are looking at this and saying, what are these crazy Massachusetts people doing? And Virginia is, by every measure, the leading colony. It's the richest, most populous, it's the biggest territory. It not only owns what is now West Virginia and Kentucky, but all the whole Midwest. And these Virginia planters are not at all happy with this destruction of property. But what happens in England? They've been appeasing, if you want to use that modern term, appeasing the colonists at every stand. 65, they repeal. 67, 68, they repeal the Townshend Duties. And I think at this point, the members of Parliament had enough. Enough is enough, and they come in with the coercive acts. Unbelievably powerful acts. Closing the port of Boston, appointing a military commander, replacing Hutchinson, and sending over a general, General Gage, to be the commander, to be the governor, to do away with the town meetings except once a year, to vote supplies, to change the constitution of Massachusetts, the charter, which is the Massachusetts people consider their constitution, by making the council appointed. When these coercive acts are seen by the Virginians, they say, if they can do that to Massachusetts, they can do that to us. And I think from that moment on, the revolution, the break, is inevitable. Right. I don't know how you.
No, I completely agree with that. I mean, the one element that I would add to that is that I think it's important to realize why it was tea that was the one duty that wasn't repealed.
Yeah, yeah.
And the point here is why don't they repeal tea? It's because remember the English East India Company, which was giving 400,000 pounds a year to the British government. Well, after Robert Clive, who's the de facto director of the East India Company, takes over and gets the right to tax Bengal in 1765, he decides that the only way you're going to collect these taxes efficiently is with a big military in Bengal. So he spends huge amounts of money militarizing Bengal, and in fact, most of the east coast of India. He builds up this extremely large army, and the East India Company builds up its own navy during this period. This costs a lot of money. In the later 1760s, the British East India Company is in fact not able to pay up on its promise of 400,000 pounds a year to the British government because he's been spending so much money militarizing, and the disruption to trade meant that there's been much less coming back. So they need to be able to sell tea. So the idea is you sell the tea to the North Americans and you get a tax from that. Sell directly from India to North America, and you get a tax from that. That will buoy up the finances of the British East India Company because they're finally able to sell all of this tea, which is just sitting there in warehouses in London.
Isn't it true though that the tea is going to be sold at a lower price?
That's right.
Even with the tax.
No. So the important thing to realize is that. At one level, it's a good deal for the Americans. They're getting tea at a lower price. It's a great deal for the British East India Company because this tea is sitting there rotting in the warehouses of London because they'd satiated the British market. So they needed to sell it somewhere. And so instead, what they're able to do from then on is sell directly from India to America. But the Americans are not actually getting a bad deal economically.
No,
the price
they're not at all. It's cheaper tea. Some problem, however, because they're Dutch. There are merchants who are involved in smuggling Dutch tea. And they think that this low-priced English tea now is going to actually make their Dutch smuggled tea put them out of business, in other words. So that's been one element that has historians have uncovered, that there were smugglers in Massachusetts who were really upset by this English tea. Before we get to questions, I just wanted to clarify one point when I said that by 1774 they had reached the position that they would, by and large, the leaders, the political nation, reached the conclusion they're tied only to the king. And if you look at the Declaration of Independence, look at it carefully. It's an indictment of George III. You, George III, have done this, a series of the tyrannical acts. They don't mention Parliament. Parliament had passed the Stamp Act. Parliament had passed the Townshend Duties. Parliament was doing a lot of things, and yet Parliament's not mentioned because they've reached, intellectually, constitutionally, they've reached a position where Parliament doesn't have any authority over them at all. So why mention Parliament? They come close when they say, you, George III, have conspired with others.
Yeah.
Others. Parliament. So the break is really against George, the king, because of this constitutional position they had reached. Now, perhaps we can open it up to you folks and ask us questions, things that you have on your mind that maybe we can try to answer. Yes, well, we can restate the question for those of you who don't hear it.
And we have two microphones on the floor that will pass around.
Wood. My question is this. If in your statement a while ago, you mentioned that sort of the concept of virtual representation sort of was back in the mist of time, the idea
right.
that it could be represented.
The source of English House of Commons, yes.
Okay, so as that comes forward and the colonies are formed, the colonists are coming from that same ethos, that idea of virtual representation. What actually allows the colonies to go through a metamorphosis to the point where they no longer think that Parliament has any say at all? I mean, is it because of the period of salutary neglect?
No, there's a century of experience creating new districts, if you will, new electoral districts. And that experience sort of reverses English history. They go back to the kind of medieval origins. Every time there's a new town created in Massachusetts, they say, okay, this town's, and we're talking 1630s, 40s, 50s, you're going to have two representatives in this general court. And the same is true in Virginia. And so that experience over 100 years just reverses the English experience, which has, you know, England started with residential requirements for its representatives. It had a coherent, going back to the 14th, 15th centuries, the origins of Parliament. But by the 17th century, these origins have been lost, and the residential requirements have long since fallen away. Even if they exist on the books, they've fallen away. So the American experience, I think, is what leads them to this, what they call actual representation. It's almost inconceivable to most of them, this notion of virtual. Daniel Delaney, one of the participants from Maryland, does agree with virtual representation in his pamphlet opposing the Stamp Act, but what he disagrees, in other words, you have to, in other words, the notion that women and children and young men without property are represented is a kind of virtual representation. They don't vote, but they're represented. So he agrees with that, that virtual representation is okay as long as there's a mutuality of interest. But where he disagrees, he says there's no mutuality of interest between us, colonists, and the British. And that right away, there's a sense of two nations, two people emerging in Delaney's pamphlet. That's the beginning of a, if you expand it out, because at the outset, they don't talk about being Americans. The term Americans is the one that Whitehall in London is using about the colonists, kind of associating with savages. In fact, when General Howe comes into harbor in June of 1776 with a bunch of Hessian soldiers, they're stunned to find that there are white people in New York City. Because the image, the popular image, is that a mongrel people mixed of Indians, natives, and black slaves, and that the whites have somehow disappeared. So the image, the popular image of the New World is really quite strange. Now, there were people who knew better, but that, I think, is an interesting fact.
Can I just add something to that? I think everything that Gordon says about the experience of the Americans and West Indians, it should be said, is absolutely right. But in addition to that, there's the effect that there's an explosion of the press in Britain, in North America, in the West Indies, and even in Bombay and Madras in the period from 1730 to the period we're talking about. So basically, before that time, the press was heavily dominated by London newspapers. So what people read in the colonies, what people read in Edinburgh, what people read in Bombay were all London newspapers. There's an explosion of the press during this period. And at the same time, after 1744, when Henry Pelham becomes Prime Minister of England, the government decides that they're going to have, instead of having partisan government, that is to say, government with a single party ruling, there's coalition governments, where you have people from different governments. And Pelham, as Prime Minister, says, if we do this, if we have all the smartest people from all the parties together, we don't need to deal with the press. We don't need to advertise our positions with the press. We should govern as technocrats and do what's best for the country. The result of that is from the 1740s onwards, the press everywhere takes the patriot position. And the patriot position from the 1740s in the press is in part about arguing against the unrepresentativeness of the Constitution, and there's a critique of virtual representation, which is in a lot of these newspapers, which get republished, and the articles are reprinted from them in the colonial newspapers, which are now in existence in Jamaica too. So it's the experience, but it's also the fact that the press is overwhelmingly a patriot press, a self-described patriot press, which has a coherent critique of virtual representation. From the 1740s onwards, I think that's right.
I mean, there's a growing gap in Great Britain between what you might call the populace and the government. The government maintains control, and of course, once the French Revolution occurs, then it's reinforced. In fact, to follow up a point you made earlier about the sense of mobbing that's going on everywhere, when they read about it in the colonies, North's government itself is suffering from mobs. He's almost killed at the doorsteps of the House of Commons by a mob. And so there's a sense that, in the English government, that the whole world is somehow coming apart. Isn't that part of the context for this? And I think that helps explain the context for the coercive acts. We've got to come down hard now, or everything will be lost.
I think that's absolutely right. And so what ends up happening, I mean, the result of the Tea Party, as it's reported in London, is to strip away some of the friends of the Americans. I mean, that is to say, their position up until then was the Americans are making coherent economic arguments against unreasonable and economically incoherent measures. So their view is, the friends of the Americans up until then is, look, we need to think about the British imperial economy as a whole. We want to have American consumers. It doesn't make sense to tax them with the Townshend duties. It doesn't make sense to do any of that. But then when the Tea Party happens, when they throw low-priced tea, which isn't hurting any consumption, into Boston Harbor, and the violence of that, that makes it much easier for North's government to say, no, you're wrong. You thought this was an economic argument. This is obviously something else. These are mobs, just like the people attacking me.
I mean, there is a real, and Steve has pointed this out, a growth of a radical element in England that is greater than the government would, than the government's actions would suggest. In fact, after the Battle of Lexington and Concord, there's a group of raising money for the victims of British oppression in Lexington and Concord. Sort of the Jane Fonda types are in England opposing the British government. And of course, that really just adds to the fear of the establishment, if you will, that things are coming apart. So there is a strong movement within England that doesn't really fulfill itself until the 19th century, largely, I think, because of the French Revolution, makes everyone in England uptight about radicalism and about revolution. How about some other questions? Yes, sir. If you can say it, maybe I can repeat it, or Steve can repeat it.
And conquered territory. And how would you relate the Quebec Act to all this? Because that was a conquered territory, whereas the Americans were settled territories, even had the real estate law that their land was supposed to be owned and free and common soakage, like the land in County Kent, as I recall.
Well, this is a big issue that historians are now writing about. How did the colonies get justified? And they're conquered territories from the English point of view. Jefferson tries a more radical position. The Quebec situation, of course, is conquered, and the English response, we didn't mention the Quebec Act, which is terribly important, because it really scares the bejesus out of the New Englanders, because it's a very liberal, enlightened act. It gives the French in Quebec the right to their religion and the right to the civil law. And this seems to these Protestant, and you have to understand that Protestantism and Englishness are really connected through the 18th century. England, that starting really with Elizabeth, the England becomes the spokes state, if you will, spokes nation for Protestantism against Roman Catholicism. And so to give the Roman Catholics in Quebec these kinds of rights to a Protestantized Englishman in Massachusetts or in New England is terrifying. They really think that some evil conspiracy has taken over. And of course, this plays into the fear of Catholicism is very strong. It plays into the Gordon riots in 1780, which go on. How many days where half of London is wiped out? So the fear of Catholicism, I think, is a major force in the period.
Yeah, I wanted to add a bit on this. I mean, I just happened last summer to find a whole series of petitions from French-speaking or Francophone inhabitants of Quebec complaining about the Quebec Act. And I think that adds a different kind of dimension to this. I mean, I think everything that Gordon says, I don't disagree with, but a really important element here was about the civil law. So the argument that the French make is that the problem with the imposition of civil law, and they wanted an imposition of English common law in Quebec is what these guys do. And there are really quite a lot of these things, and they have support from thousands of petitioners in England. What they say is with civil law is really, really bad for commercial societies, French civil law. And what you really want is English common law, because that makes it much easier to trade, it makes it much easier to sell English manufacturers, and the development of a sort of robust manufacturing society, a consumer society in Quebec. And this is absolutely a huge issue. So to get back to your question, which was, is there a distinction between settled territories and conquered territories, the argument that these Quebecois petitioners make, and they have huge support, again, from this sort of patriot wing of the Whig Party, is that there is no distinction between settled territories and conquered territories. They should all have the right to English common law, whereas the arguments of the sort of authoritarian Whig lawyers like Alexander Wedderburn and Lord Mansfield is to insist on the difference between different kinds of territories, and they make an argument for legal pluralism, that there should be different laws appropriate to different sorts of peoples in the empire. And they do the same thing in Bengal. There's the same fight over Bengal, whether there should be English common law in Bengal, or whether there should be local Muslim law in Bengal. And Alexander Wedderburn and Lord Mansfield, the same people who defended the right to French civil law in Quebec, insist that there should be Muslim law in Bengal. So this is a huge debate. It's not an issue which is settled. I mean, I think it's not right to say that there's a settled constitutional issue of the difference between settled territories versus conquered territories, but it is a really, really hot topic from the middle of the 18th century straight through the 19th century.
And you can imagine a hot topic for historians today, too. How about other questions? There's one back there, sir. Go ahead. Yeah, you. Yeah, sure. Or either of you.
You haven't commented on the cost of the British Navy and the importance of the Navy,
yes,
to the colonies and the worldwide Commonwealth. I wonder if the cost of it and the fact of it plays into this.
You have those figures right at hand?
I don't have the figures at hand. I don't know if you do. I mean, can I just say something? I've been thinking about this a lot because I just had a graduate student defend her dissertation on the British Navy in the middle of the 18th century. So the British Navy costs a lot, costs less than the Army. But one of the really important moments of the consolidation of what I've been calling this kind of authoritarian Whig faction is precisely the naval reforms of the 1740s. So Grenville is on the Navy Board. The Earl of Halifax, who's the head of the Board of Trade, is on the in the 1760s, is on the Navy Board in the 1760s. The Duke of Bedford, who's another one of the supporters of these guys, is also on the Navy Board. So what ends up happening, the 1740s is really important. It's the war, what we call, us European historians, call the War of the Austrian Succession. It's a disastrous war for Britain and its empire. I mean, they win some battles, but they don't, it's basically a series of French victories, with the exception that Britain does gain Halifax. But the argument that these guys made in the middle of the war was that the British Navy wasn't as good as the French Navy, so there needed to be radical reforms. And the radical reforms included creating a hierarchy within the Navy so that there was a clear line of command, which there hadn't been before, that the Navy actually wear uniforms. They thought this was a good idea, but that also the Navy be able to impose martial law on people who desert, wherever they desert from, and include martial and to develop these new admiralty courts, which become extremely important in North America, which can be enforced. Their rulings can be enforced by the British Navy. So what you get for the first time is this extremely hierarchically organized organization that is extremely well disciplined, much better disciplined than the British Army in the middle of the 18th century. And it is being used precisely and intentionally, because remember, Grenville's ideas come out of this, to enforce things like the Navigation Acts. Now, they don't do a great job. I mean, there's all sorts of, but the idea is very much to enforce revenue collection on the colonies from the beginning, from the 1740s. This plays a really, really important role because of a lot of incidents, some of which took place in Rhode Island.
But isn't it also true that the Navy is much more of a meritocracy than the Army? You bought your commission in the Army. If you wanted to become a captain or a major, then you bought it. The Navy, if those of you who are Jack Aubrey fans know about that merit did count. And of course, the Navy has a special place in Englishmen's hearts, going back to the Armada. So the Army is scary. The English do not like the Army stationed on their territory, which comes into play when these Townshend duties are interesting, because the cost of maintaining these forts is very expensive, all these soldiers. So what if the British ministry thinks, well, we'll save money, let's move them to Boston, to New York, to Philadelphia, it'll be cheaper to maintain them in the city than out in Detroit. And well, of course, this is crazy when you think about it. What are the troops doing in New York and Boston? You've got 4,000 troops in Boston in 1769 in a population of 15,000. Well, the consequence of that, of course, is the Boston Massacre. Yeah. And the fear of the Army is deep-rooted in English culture. And the Navy has this, first of all, the Navy's out there somewhere, and they're not on in your home. And this imposition, I think, of the Army and the importance of the Boston Massacre in 1770 is crucial. There's so many incidents that occur, so that whatever affection, whatever feelings of loyalty that a colonist had towards the mother country are slowly eroded in the course of this decade. We couldn't even begin to go over every incident that occurs that erodes what I think was a real affection. I mean, the celebration of George III's accession to the throne is really, it's quite remarkable in the colonies. Of course, they never had seen him, and they just hear about him, but he is the first really English king out of the Hanoverian line, and I think there's a tremendous amount of excitement. In 15 years, that affection is eroded through a series of little things, to the point where I think the bulk of the population was patriot. And they were working hard to undermine the British position. And the British trying to put down an insurgency, as we've come to realize, not only in Vietnam, but in Iraq and now in Afghanistan, when you're thousands of miles away, it is very, very difficult if you don't have full support of the population. And I think that, in the end, was the British long-winded answer. Yes, sir. Or whatever, whoever has the mic, I guess. I'm sorry.
I think a lot of people have a misconception about the scale of the French and Indian War versus the scale of the Revolutionary War. A lot of us, I think in terms of French and Indian War as being much smaller by nature. And I think, at least historians have put forward that the onus of defending the British colonies here in America put a special onus on us to be taxed. Can you speak to that?
Well, it is the first war of the series of wars that Steve mentioned between France and Great Britain, where the main theater of the war was North America. But it is a world war, and you may know more about it takes place throughout the whole world. And so in that sense, I think it is a terrific burden and gives a sense of release. That the colonists now feel they're free of the French and they're going to be a little more independent. And I think the British government feels the same way.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's really important to think of, I think it is, in this case, the name matters. I think it is important to realize that it's really the Seven Years' War, and it was a global war, which started in North America. It was about Western hemispheric issues, but it was fought on a global scale. Many of you have seen a map of what the status of North America looked like before the French and Indian War broke out, that in fact the North American British colonies are surrounded by French territory. The same map could be reproduced in India. Britain has these little footholds at Bombay, Madras, and Calcutta, surrounded by a series of French-allied states, indigenous states, and French control. And there's a massive war which takes place in India. And equally, on the continent of Europe, there's a massive and incredibly expensive war. France is able to bring into the field hundreds of thousands of men. And they threaten, it's important to realize, that George II and George III are not only kings of Great Britain, they're electors of Hanover as well. They threaten the elector of Hanover's territories. This is a massive, massive, massive war, an incredibly expensive war in Europe. And it's also an expensive war fighting not only in North America, but in the West Indies as well. So it's an incredibly expensive war on an unbelievable scale. So if you actually look at British expenditures in the war, it's much, much higher in the Seven Years' War, total amount of expenditures, than it is for the American Revolutionary War. It will only be surpassed in British history in the 1790s with the French Revolution.
And you know that Seven Years' War is actually, from the American point of view, it's a Nine Years' War.
It
starts in 1754 with George Washington's little venture out into what is now Lake Erie area. But the French aren't ready to go to war yet until 56, and so it becomes, from the European point of view, a 7 years war. But from our point of view,
no, it starts much
American
earlier.
Point of view, it's a 9 years war. Now there are other. I know there are a lot of questions. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Go ahead. Why don't you, we can repeat it.
Being French, I'm not going to argue in favor of civil law, although the fight is still going on. But no, I would like to ask you a question. You have mentioned all the arguments. When is for you the moment when there was a massive shift, not in the American political class, but in the public opinion, from loyalism to total independence? When that took place in relation with the tax elements?
Well, my own view is that it's when the coercive acts are passed. The feeling everywhere is this is too much. And unless the British withdraw those coercive acts, this empire is going to fall apart. Now, they don't say that, except privately, you get some sense of this, certainly someone like John Adams. But that we're talking about 1774. Now, there are still many, many colonists who want to hold the empire together, especially in the middle colonies. And there are desperate efforts to do that. John Adams goes to the Constitutional Convention, which is called in 1774, and that is a very important moment because it's for the first time they're coming together to talk about these issues since 1765 with the Stamp Act Congress. And Adams realizes that he's got to be careful. he's given some advice by a group of Pennsylvanians. It's called the Frankfurt advice in his mind, which says, cool it. You guys from Massachusetts, to use modern lingo, cool it. You guys are going too far, too fast. We got to bring these others along. And I think the Massachusetts people and many of the radicals are ready to break right then. But they realize they've got, politically, you've got to bring along the people who are doubtful and scared and actually have a lot of affection for the crown and believe, like John Dickinson did, that if you break this tie, we're going to bleed at every vein. I mean, he really did believe that the empire and being English was important. So there's a lot of hesitation. So you have a wide range of opinion, but I think the coercive acts are crucial. Then, of course, when you have Lexington and Concord in April of 1775, even though the empire is not broken, boy, that's pretty serious when you're fighting. And Washington certainly pays allegiance, toasts to the king, even though he's leading a siege of Boston in the summer and fall of 1775. And the break doesn't come until a year later, as you know. But I think my own feeling is 1774 is the crucial series of events, the coercive acts.
Can I just sort of add from a European perspective, I completely agree. I mean, I've been doing work, I'm going through the Marquess of Rockingham's papers and the papers of the Earl of Shelburne, two extremely important Whig politicians. And their view, and I should say, I want to add something with a specific French perspective on this, because this is, I'm very proud of this work that I've been doing recently. From their view, the coercive acts marks the end, because from that point forward, they think their American allies no longer feel that they can do business with Parliament. I mean, it's at that moment that they start talking about their relationship with the king, not with the imperial Parliament. And their view, from a Whig point of view, is once that happens, the relationship is broken, because Parliament is absolutely central to their notion of liberty. And once they're appealing to the king, it's at best the second best. It's at best a relationship somewhat like the Irish relationship with the British Empire, and that's not going to work. And it should be said, I mean, from the French perspective, I mean, I've been reading, in fact, I have to go in a week, back to the Ministère des Affaires étrangères, and from the perspective of the French diplomats who are writing about this, and there's also some material in the Archives Nationales from the consuls, they also see 1774 as this key moment when the British, I mean, their view is, you know, with a certain amount of glee, that the British Empire is going to fall apart. But I think there is this perspective that 1774, up until then, there was a possibility that the Whigs would regain control. They'd actually repealed the stamp. I mean, they'd done all this sort of repealing, that there was some hope that the Imperial Parliament could resuscitate the Union. But from 1774, the coercive acts get through Parliament despite vociferous protests from the Whig leaders. I mean, people like Cobham, I mean, Camden gives these incredibly bitter attacks, not only in the House of Lords, but also publicly on the streets of London, and it doesn't get anywhere. They just think that there's no way you can do business.
Yeah, the English nation is divided, and so that when the war actually breaks out, the Rockingham Whigs, the central Whig, they cannot agree to independence. They're in favor of the break because if they are in favor of independence, they cannot agree to an accommodation which would make the crown central. See, the whole Whig philosophy is based on anti-monarchical feeling, and so the Rockingham Whigs actually argue for independence, because the Carlisle Commission, any of the accommodations that are going to be made would tie the colonies to the crown. And it is, after all, a royal empire, and any enhancement of crown power is just an anathema to a good Whig, right? And so that it's this curious situation. Pitt, of course, and Chatham and the Chathamites are very much in favor of crown power and strong army and all of that. They're the hardliners in that sense of, and they're not at all upset about crown power. But that really divides the nation through the whole war, and North is really trying to hang on with a divided opposition, which enables him, I think, to hang on. But he wants to resign, and George III is the real hawk, I think, isn't he? He doesn't want to break up this empire. He writes this marvelous letter to North. He says, what will happen? It's kind of a domino theory of the empire. Well, if we go, then if the North American colonies go, then the West Indies, then Ireland, and this poor little island will be left all alone. Of course, he didn't realize that the British Empire would have, the second British Empire would have even a more glorious flourishing than the first empire. Yes, sir.
You spoke of the erosion of relations between the
affection,
mother country,
yeah,
and the colonies over a long period of time. And two contributing factors occur to me. One is geographical and the other is sociological. In other words, first of all, it took months to get news across the ocean and back again, so that the process of government was unwieldy at best. And secondly, we had had, since the 1500s, easily 200 years of opportunity to build a culture, if you will, of our own, which I believe had been diverging over that time. So could you discuss either of those factors?
Well, it's interesting what you say about the communication. Actually, in the 1970s, there was a history book on the period that we're discussing between Ben Labrie and Ian Christie.
Yeah.
They wrote a book, separate chapters. And you can, it's not in print any longer, but Christie and Labrie, one Labrie the American, Christie the British historian, both of them distinguished historians, and they alternated chapters, and they both concluded that if there'd been the instant communications that we have today, that there might not have been a revolution, and people would have been able to communicate. You're quite right, it would take 6 weeks to go back and forth. I'm not so convinced of that, but it is an interesting suggestion. Now, your other issue was?
Culture, divergent culture.
Oh, the different, of course, beneath the surface, the Americans were a very different place, although they didn't think so at the outset. They thought, and maybe they just, in other words, they were farther away from London than Cornwall, but they're not all that different from Cornwall, and they didn't see themselves as being different. It's the debate with Great Britain that takes place between 1765 and 1775 that I think exposes what had been this growing difference. They didn't think of themselves as different. They think of themselves almost uniformly as good Englishmen. And there's no sense of being of rebellion that I get earlier than the period that we're talking about. You don't have any sense that that they're a different people and they're going to separate. The English government worries about that from the very beginning of the 18th century. They're the ones that use the term the Americans over there. And you find it's the English government that's fearful of independence. And you don't get much in the way. I think what happens is the debate uncovers these different cultures. They're not that different. I mean, it's still common law. And this is the real advantage of the American Revolution over, say, the French Revolution. They were Englishmen who had had self-government for a century or more. They had a habeas corpus. They had trial by jury. They had all the things that enabled them to become self-governing. We see the problems today in the Arab Spring. These people have no experience. And that was true even of the French Revolution. They hadn't been in the States General since the 1614 of 1617. So the French had no experience with self-government. But these rebels, these American rebels, did. And I think that made all the difference.
Can I just, I think it's really important to think about that particular question in a comparative context. So the issue about news, I mean, absolutely it takes time, and this might make a big difference, but the Spanish Empire had exactly the same trouble, right? They had the same problem about getting news. And the Spanish Empire, the Spanish were, after the 7 Years' War, or maybe we should call it the 9 Years' War, I'm perfectly happy to call it that, were also beset by debt, right? But the Spanish Empire falls apart not because of any revolution. It falls apart because Napoleon successfully invades Spain and it breaks apart unwillingly. They wanted to remain loyal. So I don't think you can say just sort of news. I mean, right, I mean, they had the same, took longer to get news and information to Lima than it did to get to Boston by a long shot. So I don't think that really can play such a big factor. The sociological issue, I also think one needs to be careful about that. I'm very much along with Gordon. I don't think it's the sociological differences, because the sociological differences between, again, various of the Spanish colonies and Spain were extremely dramatic. But there was not the tradition, and the Spanish government was governed by the Spanish Empire was governed by audiencias, right, a series of courts. There was no tradition of representation, which explains some of the mess that happens in Argentina in the early 19th century. So there was this alternative tradition, this tradition of representation, and the problem, I think, and it's a problem which is articulated among the British from the beginning of the 18th century, is how do we actually coordinate to give? How do we actually give the colonists in Jamaica, in Massachusetts, in South Carolina, some form of real representation in this government? And it's precisely, I mean, I think Gordon's absolutely right. The word independency is on the mind of Tory, is on the mouths of Tory politicians from 1701. The concern about independency is a real concern. And there's this huge debate, and the difference of the kind of outcome that you get has to do, I think, in part with this kind of political tradition.
Yeah, yeah. To add something to the sociological difference, there is a difference the sense that there are no real aristocrats in the colonies. I mean, when people come from England and see George Washington's Mount Vernon, he's minor gentry. And yet in Virginia, he's a pretty big shot. I mean, there's nothing on the scale. If you've been to England and seen these country houses, I mean, the Duke of Rockingham's house was 650 feet long. I mean, that's longer than 2 football fields. And there's just nothing, you know, there's nothing like that in the colonies. Mount Vernon's a very impressive plantation, but it's miniature compared to the scale of these English aristocratic homes. So you don't have those aristocrats. It's minor gentry. They're not middle class. That would be the wrong term to apply to them. But they're not the kind of, there's not the kind of aristocracy, and they become that exist in England. Americans become very aware of that and see themselves as a much more egalitarian society. Of course, looking back from today's vantage point, they don't seem egalitarian at all, distinctions between aristocratic southern planters and their slaveholding planters and ordinary farmers seems very great. But in their minds, they see themselves as being much more egalitarian, and that is exposed as well, I think, in the revolutionary rhetoric. There must be other questions. I'm sure there were over here. Oh, okay, here.
Could you comment on the genesis of the apparent conversion of Benjamin Franklin's thought during this period of time? On a more personal note, particularly with reference to his treatment by Parliament.
Well, actually, his treatment was by one of these characters, Wedderburn, the Solicitor General. But Franklin, I've written a book on this, the Americanization of Franklin. He is really quite loyal. He goes over to London as an agent for the Pennsylvania Assembly in 1757, comes back for about 18 months to look after his post office in 1760s, mid-1764, and then goes back to England and stays there until March of 1775. So he has been, for the whole period from essentially 1757 to 1775, he has been a resident of London, leaving poor Deborah back home in Philadelphia. He comes to the revolution hesitantly. He's trying to hold the empire together. He's a really, I think, a loyal Brit. He believes in the empire, but he's also an American, and he resents, and this is an aspect that we haven't touched on, there's a kind of English arrogance that emerges, I think. And Steve can correct me on this, because he's an English historian, but there's an English arrogance that emerges in the middle of the 18th century against those peripheral parts of the Scots, the Welsh, the Irish. They're not really English. And these peripheral parts of the empire, and the North Americans, they feel this. Washington certainly felt it. He tries for a royal commission, and he's turned down, and he's being ordered around. Although he's a colonel in the Virginia militia, he's being ordered around by these captains who have a commission in the royal commission. So I think that arrogance plays a part. Franklin feels some of this, and he keeps trying to hold things together. He actually has a naive view. At one point he says, look, a couple of savvy people like myself and maybe Lord Dartmouth could sit down and we could settle these issues in a half an hour. I mean, that kind of view, the kind of the George Kennan view of diplomacy. You know, if you just get a couple of bright guys and they'll settle major problems. Franklin realizes very late he gets caught passing papers to Hutchinson letters. It's a kind of a mini scandal. And this is what leads to the accusations in the cockpit. It's by the administration. It's not Parliament. It's and the whole court turns out to witness this attack, which goes on for an hour by Wedderburn, a vicious attack, more or less saying Franklin is not a gentleman because Franklin had opened some mail. And he says, gentlemen, do not open other people's mail, that kind of attack. And from that moment on, Franklin is, I think, Americanized. But he still hangs around because Lord Chatham, William Pitt with a title, comes to visit him and that at his house in apartment in Craven Street, which, by the way, is open to the public now. There's a tourist site in London. And he's so taken with the idea that Chatham would actually come to him for advice. He stays around thinking that there's one desperate hope. And Chatham makes a statesmanlike proposal, I think, in February of 1775 to hold the empire together. But it's defeated 2-1, I think, in Parliament. It wasn't a ghost of a chance. And at that moment, Franklin realizes all is lost. And he's about to be arrested, he thinks. And he gets on a boat in March of 1775 and comes back to accusations that he's a mole, that he's a spy. And so he has to act as a super patriot to offset those rumors that someone like James Madison actually believes. He's getting information from his former college roommate at Bradford that Franklin is suspected of being a spy. So Franklin's journey to independence, to Americanization, if you will, is I think a slow one and kind of awkward one. A long-winded answer to your question, but yeah.
Yes, just a question about King George III. You've laid everything at the feet of Parliament. What was King George III's influence and role during this period?
Substantial. I mean, so George III, George II, George II had been a Whig in all sorts of ways. I mean, he was German-speaking, but he was very closely associated with Whig politics, very close to a number.
He's also his grandfather.
Grandfather. No, I didn't say his father.
Yeah.
No, his grandfather, George II. And George III, the grandson, had been educated by a series of very conservative, anti-Whiggish statesmen, politicians, including Viscount Bolingbroke. Viscount Bolingbroke, who as early as 1709 had said that if we allow the debt to grow, then we'll have a social revolution in Britain, and so we need to pay down the debt immediately. That's the kind of language that George III had been taught, and he'd obviously been read Bolingbroke's pamphlet of the Patriot King, and he's very closely associated with Bute. So he's been very closely brought up with these kind of conservative politics. And the important thing that George III does is he tries and fails. He learns, he tries to make Bute the leading minister, and Bute is so unpopular, everybody wants to get rid of him. But after that, there's a big learning curve, and George III realizes that he can get policies through. And again, I think he's very sympathetic to this sort of authoritarian Whig Tory position of tax the colonies to pay down the debt. He can get these through by putting ministers, not insisting that he gets to appoint the prime minister, but putting ministers in key positions. So it's George III who makes sure that Charles Townshend becomes Chancellor of the Exchequer against Pitt's wishes in the 1760s. So Pitt has a temper tantrum when this happens, and George III says, "You want to, you know, I want you to be prime minister, but you got to take this guy along." So he plays a very significant role, but I think to blame everything on George III, as a sort of older literature would do, is he simply didn't have the power to do whatever he wanted without significant parliamentary support. So it would be impossible to imagine George III having done all of these things to get through the Stamp Act, to get through the Townshend Duties, to get through even the Coercive Acts without a significant body of support in Parliament. He simply is able to sort of tip the balance, whereas his grandfather was able to tip the balance at key moments in the other direction.
Yeah, I think George I and George II, of course, are these Hanoverians, and they're really German. And I'm not even sure George II could speak English.
Oh, he could, but with a heavy accent.
A heavy accent. But George III is reared, he's a young man, he's only 21. It would be as if Charles dies in the English, and William immediately becomes the heir as a young man. That's what happened. He's 21 years of age, so he's really quite young for a king. When Charles eventually gets to the throne, depending on how long his mother lives, he's going to be an old man. But this was not the case with George III, and I think that youthfulness played into it. He immediately wants to appoint his tutor, chief tutor, which is Bute, who's a Scot who has no strength in the House of Commons. See, George thinks of these ministers as his ministers, and they are. He hasn't yet got the Victorian attitude towards the Constitution, which comes slowly. The British Constitution, where the monarch becomes a kind of figurehead and not really controlling the ministry, is hard to come by. George keeps thinking, these are my ministers. I'm going to appoint whom I want. And he goes through a series of ministers until he finds one he actually likes, North, who has support in the House of Commons. But he doesn't care about whether he has support in the House of Commons or not, because he says, these are my ministers. And so you've got this constitution in transition. It really takes another generation before you enter the period which is recognizably modern, where the queen or the king realizes that they have to appoint a minister who has the support of a majority of the House of Commons. That's hard to come by. George certainly screws it up because he's got
I just wanted to sort of explain constitutionally. So in the 1690s, there are a series of parliamentary acts passed to create a notion of ministerial responsibility, that ministers are liable for their actions. In the early part of the 18th century, these acts were interpreted to mean that the king was somehow obliged to go to the leaders of the party that won an election to form a government. That tradition falls away in the 1740s. It falls away in the 1740s because governments keep on falling. I mean, there's a series of reasons for this, and there's created in 1744 what was created the broad bottom ministry. After the creation of, and there's all sorts of jokes about the association of the broad bottom ministry with the significant weight of one of the ministers, so there's all these funny prints about this. But from the 1740s onwards, ministerial responsibility no longer means that whoever wins the parliamentary election necessarily gets to form the entire government. They do this much more and strongly in consultation with the king. So in fact, ironically, the Victorian constitution was much closer to being achieved in the early 18th century than in the middle of the 18th century. And what George tries to force his own prime minister on Britain with the Earl of Bute, and he realizes that's not going to work. But Bute tells him, after Bute falls, because there's huge Bute is one of the most, in fact, the most unpopular man in Britain in 1762, 1763.
Scot, besides.
But after Bute tells George III, you shouldn't seek to appoint the prime minister. You should invite whoever is the sort of most leading and most influential person in Parliament to form a government. But you should insist on getting ministers in key posts who you can trust. And that's how North's rise is precisely to succeeding Townsend after Townsend dies, and he's somebody who King George III recommends. And he recommends in part because Viscount Barrington, who was Secretary of War, had been writing to George III for a long time telling about how Lord North shares his views. So George III has a learning curve. He comes in as a young man, he just decides he wants to appoint his best, his tutor, the man he's, and he realizes that's not gonna work. But what he realizes is that he can get his policies through somewhat more subtle, although I won't say terribly subtle, means.
There are no attacks of madness in this period leading up to the revolution. That's a post-revolutionary affliction that he had. Other? Go ahead. Yeah.
At that time, about who would take over, because it was concerned that the society might bring in a monarchy of some sort. And I wondered what the English view on who might succeed the role in this country.
You mean in the Society of the Cincinnati?
No, in
monarchy?
Whether a monarchy and what the British felt about
there's increasing evidence in the 1780s of many Americans feeling that the revolution had become much too democratic, and that's the best way to describe it, that maybe we're going to have to go to a monarch. And you certainly have a lot of discussion of that sort, but it's not a dominant theme. But there are people saying this, and I have a former student, who's uncovering, and he sends me all these quotations that he's uncovering from the archives of people saying, 1786, this is too much. We really have to go back to a monarch. I don't know who it's going to be. Washington probably won't do it. Maybe we're going to have to bring one of the younger sons of George III over. There's not all that kind of talk. And there is the presumption, given the notions of social development that are common in the late 18th century, the societies start from egalitarian, simple, and they progress from, going back to hunter-gatherer through agriculture, commerce, and as you get a more sophisticated, developed society, you're going to have monarchy. That's the assumption that's widely shared in the Western world, and of course, Americans go the opposite. We become much more democratic in the period following the revolution. But there is a common theme that sooner or later we're going to have a monarch. And of course, the presidency, when it is created, as Jefferson says, that's an elected monarch. It's the Polish king. There is the feeling that George Washington is a kind of surrogate monarch. And I think that's the success of his administration without him. I'm going to talk about this tomorrow a little bit, but without him, the country would have fallen apart because he embodies monarchy. And you have to understand, people are reared in monarchy. They're used to it, that loyalty, the affection you feel for a single person. I mean, why has monarchy existed everywhere for centuries, for millennia? It satisfies a lot of human feelings, and most people in America felt that, sooner or later, we may have to go to that, but in the meantime, we've got this guy, Washington, who fulfills our dream. And the wonderful thing about it is that Washington wanted no part of that. Because he could have become a virtual king. He could have served until, in fact, most people, Jefferson, thought Washington would serve as president until he died. So there is a lot of latent monarchical feeling. But that's offset by the the sense that this we're setting off in a new direction with republicanism, and I think that's the dominant feeling. I wouldn't want to mislead you into thinking that there's strong feelings of monarchy in the...
Well, I mean, the point I want to keep on making is that there is no British sentiment. There's divided. It's a deeply, deeply divided society. And there was absolutely a apoplectic fear among some people that North America would become, the newly independent North America would become a new sort of French colony through a variety of means.
Is there any feelings of republicanism in Britain?
Yes. No, without question.
There's a Republican group?
No, there's no question. I mean, I think that there's significant amount of sentiment. And I think, I mean, this is...
Not just for Americans, but for themselves, British monarchy.
Well, there's sense of extreme limitations on the power of the king. And the argument is made over and over again that what we need to do is limit royal power, and what we need to do is, the 1780s is dominated by a rhetoric of the importance of parliamentary reform to make Parliament more responsive to the will of the people in Britain, and this plays an extremely important role. And I think one should see the massive anti-slavery agitation in Britain in the 1780s and 1790s as another element of an insistence on some sort of popular influence and trying to unseat the power of not only of what they see as a West Indian lobby, but also of a West Indian lobby in collusion with the monarch. So there is a real sort of popular sentiment. But again, there are other people who see the American Revolution as an elaborate French plot. This argument is a minority view in the 1780s, but it's a view which is held by some fairly serious people.
Yeah. Some more?
I have a question for you. I'm over here. The question is this: Professor Pincus was introduced as an expert on the Glorious Revolution. And I just wondered what the two of you thought about the theory that our ancestors had of this conflict, which was that Americans remained loyal to the principles of the Glorious Revolution, and that Britain was gradually abandoning them, and that the difference between us and them was that we were clinging to the principles of the Glorious Revolution, and they were not.
Well, my reaction, and Steve can correct me, my reaction would be that's not true. I think the legacy of the Glorious Revolution, and I hesitate to say anything about it in the presence of the world expert on it, is the supremacy of Parliament and the controls on the king. I mean, the Bill of Rights, and this is a very important distinction, English Bill of Rights is a fence put up by the people against prerogative powers of the king. Our Bill of Rights, which is 1791, is a protection against the powers of the Congress, not just the executive. And that's a world of difference. So we inherit, a sense of English liberties, English rights, but we also are fearful of legislatures. And the English Parliament remains sovereign. And remains to this day sovereign, although there are, little evidences of a kind of judicial review, but certainly nothing. There's no court in England that can say to Parliament, that is unconstitutional. The English Parliament can do away with habeas corpus by a statute, and they've done it, and they did it in Northern Ireland. So the English Parliament has a kind of sovereignty that comes out of the Glorious Revolution. Americans, that's the part that we Americans don't buy into. Our Bill of Rights limits the entire government, meaning the executive and the legislature. And this is what enables our court, and it's a slow development, to step in and say to the legislature, that act is unconstitutional. As I think it's Blackstone says, what's legal is constitutional in England. And that's the world of difference between us and them.
Well, so again, I mean, I think revolution principles, which is the sort of byword of the language, I mean, people celebrating the Glorious Revolution, right. They always talk about revolution principles. It's there are two different legacies of the revolution in 18th century Britain, of the revolution of 1688. One legacy is what happened at the revolution was to overturn what was an innovative Catholic king and sort of crazy things that he and his brother did, to return to the English ancient constitution, and the Bill of Rights guarantees that. And the English ancient constitution, according to these guys who defend this version of revolution principles, is one with limited power of the monarch. And so what the English Bill of Rights does is it makes no new law, it just repeats, it reminds the English king, you can't do X, Y, and Z. There's no new law. The only new part the only thing new in the English Bill of Rights is that a Catholic can inherit the throne. That's the only new thing. There's another version of revolution principles, which says the revolution was about two things, two other things. One was that it was about extending religious liberty, extending religious toleration. Now, of course, it's very limited. The Act of Toleration that's passed in 1689 in England merely allows nonconformists of the Church of England to go to the church of their choice. They still can't vote in parliamentary elections. So the argument of these people, people who defend this position on revolution principles, is that that was the first step. The revolution is still going on. But more importantly, for our point of view, is that there was a revolution in political economy. That the revolution was about transforming England from an agrarian society into a manufacturing society. The revolution creates the Bank of England. That's a Whig creation. And one of the major things that the Bank of England does is it gives low-interest loans to manufacturers. And the argument that these guys make is that, well, if you're going to have a manufacturing society, how can you sustain that unless you have lots of consumers? So their argument, the people who defend this version of revolution principles say, you know, taxes on consumer products, like the excise tax in England in 1733, like the Stamp Act, like the Townshend Duties, make no economic sense. So there is an argument about revolution principles that, in fact, what the British government, what the government of Lord North was doing, what the government of George Grenville had done, was a violation of revolution principles. And this is said openly in England in 1760s and 1770s. John Wilkes, who was the most important of the radicals, I mean, radical spokesman in the 1760s, says over and over and over again that the government that we now have is violating revolution principles. And that's why when Paul Revere, you know, that nice bull, which is in the British, the MFA, in the Museum of Fine Arts, celebrating the sort of success of non-importation, says on the other side, Wilkes and Liberty.
Right, right. No, I think you're quite right. The financial revolution that occurs in England is really quite extraordinary and enables this little, when you think about it, this little island with a third of the population of France off the northwest coast of Europe to become the greatest power since the fall of Rome. I mean, it seemed to many people to be a miracle, even more of a miracle than the Dutch explosion of the previous century. So what's the secret? I think it's the ability, and this is not my view, I mean, it's been widely said by historians, that the English were able to tax their people, to get revenue without impoverishing them. The French kings could not do that. And that's the secret of the financial system, which, of course, Hamilton is quite aware of. Almost unique among the major founders, he understands what a bank is, and Hamilton Hamilton's program of the 1790s is really an attempt to copy, to do what the English had done so successfully, and it really is impressive to be able to tax their people without impoverishing them. The French kings could not do that. All they could do is farm out. They just go bankrupt. I mean, they just declare bankruptcy, so to speak, and all those creditors who lent money to Louis the 14th, 15th, they just go, too bad. I mean, that was not the debt system that the English developed, I think, was crucial in creating that powerful empire, first empire.
And it created the logic that we're sort of dealing with today. That is, I've been dealing with, well, today, but also then. Right. That so once you have this debt system, you can do all of these things, but you have to have some credible story about how you're going to repay the debt.
Right.
And that's why you have this debate between those who want austerity and those who want a sort of, you know, a sort of growth sort of strategy.
Nothing changes, right?
Yeah.
Right. A question. You had said that. Okay. You said before that sociologically that many of the people in the American colonies felt a kinship with England, but we've been taught, of course, that there was a very special special culture here, because I think England exported a lot of its problems to the colonies. You know, prisoners who were trying to populate the colonies, in their championship of the Protestant cause, funneling the Huguenots, the Palatine Germans here, then the difficulties in Scotland, religious persecution, the rack rents in Ireland, and then what do you do with the Scots colonists in Northern Ireland? And, you know, so and all of those people, there seems to be a dichotomy of the coastal areas of the Americas, and then the Piedmont and the inland frontiers seemed to be the places just prior to the Revolution, right, where a lot of those people were funneled. And so that I think at least territorially, a large part of the colonies were populated by people that didn't have that kind of kinship with the
English. That's a good point. I mean, the Germans constituted probably, some estimates, a third of the population of Pennsylvania, but they were politically quiet, and they, like the Mennonites, they were caught up in their religion and simply not engaged much in politics. There were lots of Scotch-Irish. The census of 1790 shows, I think, about 40%, maybe 50% of the population is English. Scotch-Irish, a huge percentage, you know, 20 maybe, some French, Dutch, and Scots, just plain Scots. You're right about the Scotch-Irish. They tended to come in large numbers from the middle of the 18th century and go down the Shenandoah Valley into the Carolinas. And that did create problems. So that the Scotch in the West, the Scotch-Irish in the West, were being oppressed by Eastern Whig governments. And when the Revolution breaks out, they more or less take the view, the enemy of my enemy has got to be my friend. So you have a lot of loyalism in the western part of the Carolinas, which tears up the Carolinas. There's a lot of ability by the British to recruit loyalist militia in the western parts of the Carolinas, and makes for really some bloody warfare there. But by and large, I think there's more support for the Revolution. There's often this one-third, one-third, one-third. I think the best estimates now, that is one-third loyalist, one-third patriot, and one-third neutral. I think it's that about 20% of the population was loyalist. Of the, that's about, 500,000 of a population of 2.5 million. And of those 500,000, about 80 to 100,000 actually left and went off to Canada or to the Jamaica or back to England itself. And I think the bulk of the population was patriot, and therefore the British misunderstood. Certainly when Burgoyne comes down the Hudson Valley, he's counting on a lot of loyal support, and instead he gets patriot harassment right from the beginning. And his army is carved away, eroded. The patriots really, I think, dominated, especially in some areas. Virginia, there's almost no loyalism. Maybe because the British governor, one of his last things he does is try to turn the slaves against their masters, and that made these masters and the political elite very, very patriotic. Anyway, that's my take on the.
Can I just add a little bit? I mean, this is an interesting question, just because, I mean, I have two graduate students who are actually working on this problem right now of the migrant communities. And one of the interesting things that the one who's farthest along is finding is that among the Huguenots and the Palatines, that they tended to sort of imbibe relatively radical patriot ideas from the moment they went, that there was a certain set of political tests of who was willing to go to North America, and they were much more likely to have fairly patriot sorts of views. Now, the Scots-Irish and the Scots are slightly complicated because she's finding that there's real differences in terms of where they actually came from. And it's difficult to know with a lot of the Scots-Irish because a lot of them came from Scotland, go to Ulster, and then come over, and it's difficult to know exactly how much time they actually spent in Ireland before coming in some of the cases. But what she's finding again is that, and I mean exactly what Gordon was saying, is that there's huge disagreements, that those who go more inland also tended to be people from Highland backgrounds. That is to say, they tended to come from the sort of the clanship areas, and those people tended to be much more likely to be loyalist, whereas those who came from either from Northern Ireland, and these tended to be manufacturers, right? Because Northern Ireland in the middle of the 18th century became the center of the Irish linen manufacturing. A lot of these people came over because they thought they could make more money in North America. These people tended to be, and the people who came from the Scottish lowlands through Ulster, they tended to be much more likely to turn out to be patriots. So there seems to be a real division, and that you can sort of reproduce. I mean, what seems to be coming out is that you can reproduce some of the social and ethnic tensions which existed in Scotland and in Ireland with what ends up happening.
You ought to read David Fisher's book. Yeah. David is talking tonight on Washington. He's written a really powerfully argued book on the origins of immigrants to North America. It's worth reading.
I think it's a testimony to the skills of these two gentlemen that we have reached a time when I'm sure a great many of you are hungry.
Thank you very much.
Good.